So hi, everybody. Thank you for coming for my talk. My name is Idit Levine, and I'm working in EMC in the CTO office. I'm also the CTO of EMC Cambridge Dojo, Cloud Foundry. And I wanted to share with you a very cool project that we did called Project UniK. That was an advanced development that me and two more developers kind of like spin up. And we feel that this is very cool. We wanted to share with you. So first, let's start talking about the motivation. Why did we do this? So if you're looking around, you see the stack. This is the stack that today most of the enterprise is using, specifically if they're using Cloud Foundry, right? So there is the hardware. There is the hardware drivers. Then on top of it, there is usually a hypervisor. There is virtual hard drivers. And then you have the OS kernel. Then on the operating system, you have also the OS user processes, right? Then that basically separate your processes. On top of it, you have Docker, right? That kind of doing the same thing. And then on top of it, you have the shared libraries. You're putting it inside your Docker container. Then you have your language runtime, your application, and your application config. All of this, all this huge stack is what you're running every time that you want to run. The question is, why do we need all this stack? And what is important to us to recognize is that the only reason we actually need all this stack is because we want to run a single application with a single user on a single server. That's all we really want to achieve. And we have all this huge stack, right, with all those layers. And if you're looking at this layer, there is a lot of redundancy. For instance, isolation is a great example. You have the physical isolation on the hardware, right? Then you have the hypervisor itself who isolate the VM. You have the OS user processes who separate the processes. Then you have Docker runtime who basically doing the same thing. Then you have your application who separate your users, right? So a lot of redundancy and inefficiency. So now let's look at the kernel 1 second and see if there is any complexity there. And if we're looking at the kernel, we see that most of the complexity is coming from the one target that the kernel should do, which is protect, right? It should protect application from application, should protect user from user, and it should protect application from user, right? So this is basically one of the main jobs for the kernel. The question is, does it really need it? Like, that was very, very make sense on the 50 and 60 when we bought this huge computer, it was very expensive, and as a business use case, we decided that we cannot afford ourselves to buy this huge computer based one for application. And therefore, what we did, we had to share it, right? Because it costs a lot of money. But today we're not doing it, right? Today that's not the model. Today you can actually run a really small computer VM with what you need. If you're looking at the microservices architecture, there is a lot of duplication that Linux kind of already did for us. If you're looking at library like etc, you will see that basically what Cora is doing with etcd, it's kind of like a like, just in distributed way, but there is a lot of stuff that the operating system actually already giving us, and we duplicated on the microservice architecture. And if we're looking at other inefficiency, if we're looking at something like the kernel, and we're looking at the driver that's running inside the kernel, we will be surprised to discover that there is a floppy driver there. I didn't see a lot of time floppy actually driver attached to a machine, but you still have the bit and the byte on your computer. Same thing for USB. You're running on Amazon, on AWS. You can't even get to the machine. You still have the USB driver. So a lot of unnecessary stuff running on your laptop constantly. Now, on your laptop or on your infrastructure. And what is important to say is that every other company that's trying to attack this today, like CoreOS, for instance, they're trying to attack the operating system destroyer. They never touch the unikernel, the kernel itself, which means that in the kernel, you still have a lot of unnecessary code. And if you're looking at the update model today, so when you're doing, I don't know, if you're running Fedora and you're doing YAM, or if you're running Ubuntu and you're doing GitHub, you're getting a lot of stuff to your computer. I don't know if you really know what you're getting, but a lot of the stuff probably are not necessary. You're still getting in and paying for the storage and for all this bit and byte running. So CIO probably will appreciate this slide because also in the security, there is quite a lot of problem because the kernel is so big and the operating system is so big, the surface of attack is huge, right? I mean, I can think about a lot of components that I can actually use in order to attack those operating systems. And when you're looking at Linux, which is a very popular operating system, there is a lot of explosive targeting in it. Versus the hypervisor, people are less targeted because it's usually behind the internet, right? You're not exposed to the internet. And the last security problem that I notice is the microservices architecture sharing a lot of stuff, right? You're sharing the kernel, you're sharing the memory, you're sharing the file system, you're sharing the hardware, you're sharing quite a lot of stuff. And the only thing that actually protects it is extension like cgroup, a kernel extension like cgroup. So again, it's not very native, right? So let's look 1 second a little bit more about the Linux kernel. This is an example for how many technologies you need to know in order to actually maintain the Linux kernel. It's going on and on. And I will argue that there is not a lot of people in the world that are actually capable of doing it. So very complicated. If you're looking at the source line of code, this is like my estimation. I think that a small application is around 10K line of code. This is what usually we like to say. If you're looking at medium and large, it's probably around 100K line of code. When you're looking at a big one, huge, the team is actually maintained, probably 1 million lines of code. This is only the kernel of the Linux, 22 million lines of code, right? If you're looking at the Debian distro, 419 lines of code. This is huge. There's no, you know, it's very hard to maintain, tons of technical debt, and it's just very hard to reason about, right? So this is basically the, you know, the ratio between the line of code of the kernel and the distro. So the question is, how did we get there, right? I mean, I just described you tons of inefficiency that we're running every day in your infrastructure. And what I came with is that it's probably a regular, you know, it's an evolution, right? We started with a big computer, we went all the way to the personal computer, all the way to, you know, to your Mac and your Android. And the only thing that common between all of this is basically Unix, right? It supported us all the way. So what can Linux run on? Anything, right? What can run on Linux? Anything. I can seriously take right now the last Ubuntu distro, run it on my 10 years Pentium 1 laptop. It's just going to work, right? I don't need to do anything out of the box. So we made a trade-off, right? We made a trade-off as a community. We decided that it's more important to us to support compatibility versus efficiency, okay. Right? So we make it work, right? I mean, we are running it in your data center. It's quite very, you know, it's performable. There is Google and of the world, and they're running very efficiently. But it's not right. The architecture is wrong. And what I offer right now is that let's make it right, and hopefully after it, let's make it fast. So what I suggest is to use Unikernel. So let's talk a little bit about Unikernel. So the traditional approach today when you're running, you have the kernel itself, and then you have all the libraries on top of it and your application. This is the stack that you're getting no matter which application you're running. It's always looked the same. This is in your operating system and that's what you're running. The question is, do I really need that? And you don't really, right? You only need what your application actually consumes. So the unikernel approach saying, let's just take just the white triangle that we really need in order to run our application. So you're not going to have the full kernel, you're not going to have the driver that you don't need. You're only going to have the driver that you actually need in order to run this unikernel. So this is, sounds like a magic. How does it actually work, right? So what we're doing is we're taking your application code, binaries, right? You're taking your config, you're taking your dependency, you're taking your runtime, language runtime that you need to support your application, and you're taking your virtual drivers. And you're putting all of this in some packaging tool, right, that the unikernel ecosystem already creating for us. There is a few of them. And the end result is just a unikernel. And unikernel is basically a bootable image, right? So it can run either on hypervisor or bare metal, right, because it's basically a bootable image. So if it's running on hypervisor, it's it's on machine, right? It's a real VM. Everything that we already know about hypervisor will work here, right? If you want to vMotion it, if you want, all of these things is going to work because it's running on an hypervisor. But Unikernel will have their own network stack, they have their own virtual memory, and they contain, and hopefully immutable. That's what we hope. So what did we do here? This is the stack. We just remove everything that we don't need, right? Very simple, just remove what we don't need. Much easy to reason about, less layers, and so on. So let's just summarize what is the advantage of Unikernel. So the first thing is that there is no other user. The only user that there is no multi-user support. You can add a multi-support for your application, but it's not going to be when you log into your machine, right? No permission check. And this is kind of like key, because now you don't need to do a context switch, and you're running on actually ring zero, which means that you, on kernel mode, which means that you can actually utilize 100% of your hardware. Your application doesn't need to switch between the kernel mode to the user mode. It's just running in the kernel mode, much quicker, much more performance. Isolation only in the virtual hardware. You're only sharing hardware, which is very, very important, right? Now, if we're talking about sizes, the minimum virtual machine that you're taking today with an operating system, it's probably 1 gig. This is what usually people are working with, right? The minimum before you're putting your application. The Unikernel is case, right? So, I mean, if you're putting, basically, the size of the Unikernel is the size of your application, right? Because it's very, very tiny. And because there is not a lot of line of code, not 22 million, only like 1,000 or so, it's very quick to boot up, right? There's not a lot of line to actually boot. So the booting time, the performance time is as quick as container at least, right, if not more. And the last thing is that the surface of attack, it's very, very tiny, because if you think about it, there's not a lot to attack. You don't have SSH to this machine. How can you attack a machine that it's very, you know, it's almost impossible to log into it? But it's not only that the surface of attack is tiny, it's also customizable, which means the Unikernel will look differently between different applications. So if I have one application that's running on this Unikernel, the libraries will be different than another application. So even if I was very, very, you know, smart and managed to attack this application, I would not be able to do that on a different one. So it's very customizable. So last slide about Unikernel. Basically, there's two types in the ecosystem today. There is the forward compatibility, which is basically the language specific. So it's very performable, but it will work only with a specific language. A good example will be Docker just acquired in the beginning of the year a company called Unikernel System. They are focusing on something called Mirage OS. Mirage OS only supports OCaml as a language. So if you don't know how to write OCaml, you're few from Cambridge, UK, you're basically capable of running that and get a very, very killer performance. But most of us don't write OCaml, or at least didn't use it until now. And therefore, we're going to use the other one, which is the POSIX compliance. So POSIX is basically the API of the operating system, and therefore, it's supporting most of the language that we know today. So you can run C, C++, Go, Node.js, Ruby, Python, and name it. It's going to work, right? So what did we do, right? Because all I described right now, it's only what is the motivation. When I saw this, I said to myself, why not everybody using Unikernel? It's just very, very good. And what I realized is that the reason people not using it, because it's very hard, right? You need to take your driver, and you need to understand how it's working. Very complicated to work with. And if you think about it, this is exactly what Docker did to Linux container. Linux container was there for a long time, but it couldn't actually be used because it was very hard for the developer to understand what's going on there. What Docker did, they make it very easy to use. So what we did is exactly the same thing for Unikernel, basically creating a command line, REST API tool that make it very easy for you. It's abstract from you all this mess. You're just pushing your application, and we're taking care of the rest. So it's called UniK. So how does UniK work? Very simple, right? Very light Docker. So UniK daemon will set up your environment. Mainly it will set up the daemon itself, right, of the UniK. And if you're running and you don't have your infrastructure DNS, we also spin up a new UniK kernel, actually, which is very cool because it's 300 meg that actually will give DNS to you. So if you're running on something like vSphere, then you just build your application, your unikernel, then you can attach volumes, and then you can just run it. Very, very simple to use. So for my opinion, this is the most important slide that I hope that you will take from here, is the fact that we were, I believe that we were very, very smart about making a decision about how to architect UniK. And because this ecosystem is very, very new, we didn't know what we'll catch. We didn't want to bet on one unikernel type, and we didn't want to bet on one cloud, and we didn't want to bet on processors. We just wanted it to be very, very pluggable. So what we did, we make UniK very not opinionated. So today, if you wanted to add, you know, out of the box, we're supporting RAM kernel, which for my opinion, the best unikernel today. There is a Mirage OS, which as I said, is language specific, and OS3, specifically very important if you're running Java. So we're supporting all of those, right? But there is more, and we invited the community to help us create a compiler for them, right? In terms of cloud provider, out of the box, AWS, that was the first one we did. Then we added all the vSphere, so it's supporting vSphere, and it's supporting Futon, the new platform on, at scale of VMware. We also want you to have the ability to run it on your laptop, because we think it's very cool. So we're supporting right now VirtualBox. We're going to add a QMU and KVM very soon. So basically what we're trying to do is cover most of the ecosystem that you can run it whenever you like. And we're also working on OpenStack as we speak, actually. And the other thing is that we didn't want to be only Intel specific, because my belief is that the big use case for unikernel will be in the Internet of Things. People can argue about if it's suitable for cloud, yes, if it's too mature, but no one will argue that this is the best fit for Internet of Things. And for a few reasons. One of them, very small footprint, right? It's not taking a lot of storage. Second of all, very performable. And third one, very secure. So like the third quality, I think this is like perfect fit for, Internet of Things. And this is why we decided to support ARM as well, to show that this is, can run on those embedded devices. But we wanted to make it easy for you to run. So what we're working on it right now is UniK app. Not always the guys who are actually building the UniK will be the one that's running it. So we want to make sure that you can pull and push. And also it will make an easier experience to try in. Okay, so we didn't stop there because we know how the community really, really like Docker API. So it was very important to us that it was not going to be very hard to adopt. So what we did, we basically teach UniK how to speak Docker API. So today you can just use the minus H flag in Docker, target daemon of UniK instead of Docker, and then you basically can do Docker run, Docker build, Docker PS, Docker RM. It's just going to work for you out of the box. So you don't need to change any script that you had before. It's going to work. But our main target, as the CTO of EMC Dojo, was to integrate it with Cloud Foundry, because we feel that that will be the best experience for the user. So what we did is exactly that. Today, if you're running Cloud Foundry, you can run it on a regular, you know, if you're pushing it, it will go to the old architecture of Cloud Foundry. If you're pushing it with enabled Diego flag, it's going to go to the Diego new architecture. If you're doing right now enable UniK, it's going to go and run unikernel. So the same application you can do, push to Diego or push to unikernel, is going to work. Demo? Let's see demo. So, is that big enough? I don't know. Okay. Can you see that? It's good? Okay. So, the first thing that we will do is we will do UniK Q. That will tell us what is the unikernel that I already compiled. So, what are unikernel when after I compile unikernel, I'm getting, it depends where I'm running, but what I'm getting is a bootable image. If I'm running in AWS, I will get an AMI. If I'm running on a VMware, I will get a VMDK, okay? So basically what you see is that before that, I had an application that, I built already. Now what we're going to do is UniK PS. That will tell me what I'm running already. So as you see, I'm not running anything. So let's just go and run something real quick. So UniK, run, and the name of the application. That's simple, right? So that's specifically running on AWS, and as you see, I have a unikernel running. So that's quick, right? If we're going to go just to see that, let's do UniK PS. Let's grab the IP. go to a website, a new one. And as you see, we have very stupid static Go website running. Whoever know me know that I'm really adored Steve Jobs, so every demo that I have will be with Steve Jobs. So as you see, we have Steve Jobs running, right? So that's cool, it was very, very simple, but now let's build one, okay? So again, it's very simple, unique, push, let's give it a name. I'm not on the first place, one sec. I just want to make sure that I'm on the right place. Yeah. Yes, for example, app. Okay, so now let's run it. The only thing that I'm doing is unique run a build push, and I'm giving it a name. Let's give it CF, and I'm running it. And what you will see right now that it's starting building the unikernel. That will take a sec. So let's go for the meantime and look at the Cloud Foundry one, integration. So what you see is I have a Cloud Foundry here, hopefully it's up. So we have no application running, right? Can you see it good? Do you want me to? Okay. So we don't have application running. What we're going to do right now is go and push an application. Let's see that just the right. So the only thing that I need to do is CF push. So see what I'm doing here. There is CF push, I'm not starting the application, and then I'm enabling UniK. I'm giving the endpoint of UniK, and I'm starting it, right? So this is basically what I'm going to do. What you will see right now is that it will go, it will build it, you're using the build pack. It will take a minute. Let's continue looking at it. So as you see, it's running all the build pack. It will take the build bucket of the unikernel that we build. It's going to support everything that, Cloud Foundry support today. Logs, if you need you know, the router, everything out of the box will work for you, right? So as you see, it will work right now. So while it's doing it, what I would suggest is that let's go 1 second back and see a little bit more demos while it's working. So as I said to you, the thing that I believe is that Internet of Things will be a killer use case. And we decided that instead of wait for that to happen, we should do it. So the future is how to create. What we did here, we basically took a Raspberry Pi and we attached it to another Raspberry Pi that actually debugging the Raspberry Pi. And we were the first people in the world that actually run unikernel of RAM kernel on a Raspberry Pi. As you see, this is how we're working on it. There is the GDB that actually debugging it, and that's exactly how we did it. So what I want to show you for the meantime is a quick demo of how we did that. And what I'm going to do right now, I will ask UniK to push unikernel to a Raspberry Pi that will talk to the toaster and will make us toast because I skipped breakfast, okay? So you want to do that? Let's do it real quick. Just verify that. You see, so this is still building the, application. This one is already ready, so if I will go right now, just quick, I will show you this before we're moving. So if we're doing UniK right now, you will see that we built another application. It's probably waking up. Yeah, you see CF that we just built? So now we have the unikernel, we can do again CF. Now, if we want to do logs, just before we're doing this, I will say, if you want to do, you can do unique logs, the name of the PS that's running. So let's first do unique PS. And then unique logs, putting the unikernel name. And what you can see, this is the actual booting of the unikernel. Now you need to understand unikernel is actually running, it's the kernel itself running inside and your application inside the kernel, right? It's kind of like wrapped together. So as you see, it's actually putting up your application, you know, the operated system, and then it will boot up your application. Okay, so now let's do this. In order to do that, we need to switch network. Sec. Okay, buddy. Okay, switching the kernel. So I'm connecting to the network. We are going to run this real quick. The website. Okay. So you see right now, that should work. Okay, so this is basically the website that I built. And what I will do right now is I'm going to plug in everything, and I'm going to click. Oh, I forgot to put the toaster though. So I have bread, right? I'm going to put it in the toaster, close it. As you can see, it's closed, not working. The Raspberry Pi is attached, and then let's just ask UniK. That's it. Okay. So now, soon hopefully it will start working. So again, what's happening is we put a U-boot. I don't know if you know what it is, but it's basically boot on network on the Raspberry Pi. It's waking up, it's going to UniK, it said, do I have something to run? Taking all the UniK kernel, it's putting it on the Raspberry Pi. We should switch this switch was going to open the disk. So now what you see is that it started it, and this one is working, right? So let it work. And then the last thing, let's just see what's going on with Cloud Foundry. Let's go back to the network. Oh, it's well. Let's do CF apps. We have one application running. Hopefully it will work if it didn't fail because it looks bad. It's maybe because I switched network. So as you see, this is his Cloud Foundry running Steve Jobs, different Steve Jobs. Now what we can do real quick, because I know I'm out of time, let's go and scale this application real quick. So I'm doing CF scale, right? I'm scaling it to 3. So now I have 3 instances of 3 UniK kernel running, right, in Cloud Foundry. Let's go quick today. Let's go here to UniK and do UniK PS. What you see is that there is 4 UniK kernel running. The first one is the unikernel demo that we did the first one. Then there is 3 example app, right? Now what we're going to do, we're going to kill it from UniK. So I'm basically doing UniK, RM, and just choosing one of them. Doesn't really matter which. So what you will see now and what I want to show you is that basically what will happen is that Cloud Foundry will just add a new one, right? Because it just lost one of the UniK kernel. So if you're looking right now, this one is shutting down, and we'll soon Cloud Foundry will add us a new one. So until that's working, any question? No? Yes, forgot to say that. Yeah, we did open source it. So you can go to the GitHub. We really like open source. So you can go to the GitHub of us. Just open one of them. Just maybe GitHub. So you can go here. It's open source. As you see, the community actually really digging. Already 299 stars, great traffics. People are coming. People are cloning. People are watching. So the community actually really, really dig into it, and I really suggest that you will do the same. There is a very, very easy kickstart. We did everything so simple, like it's Docker and it's running. So really, like, go try it. Let's see if Diego actually got it. Oh, I don't know. Diego is not recover. Okay. Oh, yeah, you see. So see, so I have one shutting down application, three new one, right? Like, basically, I have three instances that I want to ask for Cloud Foundry. And the last thing, because I think we are done, is that you can see that the toaster is actually working. We can eat. That's it. I mean, do you have any other questions? Different from microkernel?
Yeah.
But so, the microkernels have been around for a while, I mean, for a long time. So.
Yeah, I mean, let me take it with you offline.
Okay.
I will answer that. Do you have other? Yes. No, so the thing is that what I'm doing is I'm running unikernel instead of container. The only limitation is that this is, as you say, it's one user. So, which means that I cannot fork. That's the only limitation that I have on the platform itself, right? So application that you're forking will not work. Yeah, so I mean, this is a regular Cloud Foundry distro, right? The only thing that I did is I basically created the backend, so when I'm running it, instead of running containers, we run on unikernel. Okay, other question? No? You all set? I think we're late. Okay, so thank you guys.